for attending my presentations. So let me start my presentations. My presentation title is Super Long-Term Support, SLTS Kernel and Base Layer Development in the Civil Infrastructure Platform. My name is Yoshitake Kobayashi, just call me Yoshi, and I'm from a CIP project. At the beginning of my presentations, I would like to say our civilization is run by Linux. So there are some examples. For example, transportation, such as vehicle control systems, runs on Linux. And for energy power plant, for example, turbine control is already runs on Linux. And for industrial systems, industrial automation and industrial communications and some other stuff runs on Linux, and healthcare and build automations and many kinds of stuff which relate on civil infrastructure runs on Linux. But there are some issues to be solved. I would like to mention about one example in railway systems. Railway systems, once we build up this kind of systems, it has to be survive 25 to 50 years. When we create this railway systems, we have 3 to 5 years development time. Within this development time, we spend 2 to 4 years for customer specific extensions. And then 1 year initial safety certification and authorizations, which means if Linux kernel supports, for example, LTS, it's already expired. So after we release, we also provide some follow-up releases to fix critical bugs or sometimes add some features. But in that case, we also need to spend 3 to 6 months for safety certification and authorizations. And then with the systems has to be survived 25 or 50 years. This is just an example. And what we done on the Linux for civil infrastructure system is we improve real-time capability and real-time performance and test a lot. And we also improve reliability and test a lot. And we also create a lot of documents for open source software license compliances and export control classifications, of course. Then we support for a long time, such as 20 to sometimes 60 years. So we have a big problem. The problem we face is that kind of systems has to be support for a very long time. And currently, this kind of super long-term support done by individual companies. So it means each company spends a lot of effort to provide a long-term support. And on the other hand, their systems not only have survived a long time, but also we have to have an industrial grade, which include robustness, secure, and reliable systems. And now we also need to catch up with the latest technology trends, such as IoT. So the solution we need is, of course, that kind of systems has to have long-term maintenance period, but also have industrial grade. Currently, we are doing individually, but most of effort can be shared by each related companies. So our solution is collaborative development. So we need a collaborative framework to maintain same open source based system for many, many years to keep secure, robust, and reliable. And this kind of effort we also would like to collaborate in the upstream communities. Because upstream first policy is quite important policy for us, because if we have local changes, we will face our local issues. We would like to share common issues with upstream projects. So CIP is our solution. So CIP aims to establish an open source base layer, which have industrial grade. So this sentence have on the top page of CIP project website. So our requirements for civil infrastructure systems mainly categorize three parts. First part is industrial grade, which have reliability and functional safety and security and real-time capability, some stuff, something like that. And of course, we have a sustainability for a longer time period. And currently, a civil infrastructure system have, unfortunately, very conservative upgrade and maintenance strategies, because we don't want to make newer issues to by upgrading systems. So we have to make sure what kind of changes has been made on to fix this kind of bug or something like that. So we would like to share this kind of development costs and also maintenance costs to minimize as possible. So if we success to share this kind of effort, we are also able to make shorter development time for each systems. So we try to create an open source base layer. This slide shows what the open source base layer is. So open source base layer means open source base reference implementations, which includes super long time supported kernel and userland, minimized userland at the beginning. So this kind this minimized environment can be used with other packages, but if we try to support whole set of the distribution, it's quite difficult for that. We first would like to focus very critical part of for our requirements. So this slide shows our scope of activities. And CIP have established in April last year, so it's about 10 months now, and most of people, I think, currently consider CIP is just long-term supported project. But actually, we are considering a lot of technical issues, such as real-time stuff. So at the beginning, we also created a lot this kind of technical map, which includes many technical topics. And what kind of topics can be collaborate with other open source projects, and what kind of topics has to be considered by CIP inside. So this kind of stuff is keeping updated. So, but I would like to focus on simplified one. And currently, we focusing on this red part. First one, of course, we started from the long-term support at the initial effort, and then extend to the test automations, because testing is quite important for our use case to survive the systems for a long time. And then we also are currently focusing a strong interest in the real-time support stuff. So current status of the CIP base layer development is considered two parts. One part is a CIP super long-term supported kernel. So we have already decided CIP kernel version as 4.4. 4.4 is the initial CIP kernel version, which supports super long time. And this supported by a maintainer, Ben Hutchings, is an initial CIP kernel maintainer. So he has a lot of experience to maintain a kernel for a long time. So, and we also define kernel maintenance policies, which is also already documented in the CIP wiki site. So because we need to define our own maintenance policies. Otherwise, we just get some issues in the future. And we already started maintenance. Linux 4.4.48-CIP2 has already released on the 10th of February, so about 2 weeks ago. And now we are creating a CIP kernel test framework to continue testing. For the CIP core package development, we consider four steps. At first, we define an initial component set, then component versions. And also, if we need to have some features, we also should contribute to upstream project, then maintain. But now, we just at the beginning. So the following slide, I would like to describe SLTS kernel development and CIP testing, and also base layer development. So first, CIP SLTS kernel development. So this is an overview of the CIP SLTS kernel development. CIP SLTS, we plan to have two trees. One tree is for CIP SLTS, this is the official CIP SLTS kernel tree, which is available on the kernel.org under the Ben Hutching directory. And this is based on the Linux stable kernels. Currently, this is maintained by Greg Hartman. CIP kernel maintainer is Ben Hutching because we have some backported features on top of the stable kernel tree. So this CIP stable kernel tree validated by CIP. And the second tree is a CIP SLTS plus preempt RT patches. We plan to have these trees because most of systems depending on preempt RT, because we should have most of the products, we should have real time capabilities. So this CIP kernel tree based on the stable RT and also CIP backported features. And this is separately maintained by CIP members currently. So the maintenance period we are currently planning is at least 10 years or more. And sometimes we need 20 years maintenance period, but it depends on our requirements. So this is the initial requirement for CIP SLTS kernels. And this slide describes the kernel development trees. Currently, on the mainline and the stable kernel tree, 4.4 is already a LTS kernel. But this LTS kernel will be stopped to maintain for several years later. After that, we would like to take over from this kernel from the maintainers. And this CIP kernel have some backported features from the upstream and maintained by Ben Hutching. And based on this one and preempt RT, we also have a stable RT base branch. So this is also validated by CIP members. So once we start maintain about IOSS, which means LTS kernel already 2 years old or more, which means most of the features difficult to backport. So which means, so we considering to backport some futures for maybe 2 years, but after 2 or 3 years later, we stop and focus to security fix only. Oops. And we decided the kernel maintenance policy, which is available on the CIP website. And I can show you. Hang on. This is available on the CIP website, but this is a bit longer. And I summarize this maintenance policies. We basically follow the stable kernel development rule. But the difference in between the stable kernel and CIP kernel is we accepted backported futures. However, we accepted the backport futures. All futures has to be upstreamed before start backporting. This is very important policies because if we just take some out of tree patches, but after that, probably this kind of patches will become part of upstream. So it causes a serious conflict in between that. So we don't want to make this kind of conflict in the CIP kernels. So this is why we consider CIP consider upstream first policy is important. And of course, validation will be done by CIP infrastructures. And current backported futures on 4.4 CIP is related on the kernel self-protection projects features. So these three features have already backported to CIP kernel because security is quite important issues for us in the future. So this is why we decide backported from the KSPP project. So this kind of feature, of course, already upstreamed. So this is why also we decided to do that. So I would like to mention about also out-of-tree drivers. In general, all out-of-tree drivers are unsupported by CIP. However, of course, user can use CIP kernel with out-of-tree drivers at your own risk. So if someone use out-of-tree drivers with CIP kernel, please make sure if you find when you find some bugs on your own CIP modified kernel, its issues also on the CIP original kernel or not. Otherwise, we cannot answer these kind of questions. So this is a quite important policies. But even user can use a CIP kernel tree at your own risk, but there are some barriers because we direct to focus on security fixes which support for 10 years. So which means that kind of effort can be shared, even the out of tree included by your own local tree or something. So our major version release cycle, we are considering next SLTS kernel version, but it's too early to announce because if we release one SLTS kernel every year and then support it more than 10 years, which means after 10 years, we have to support 10 branches. So it's unable to do that by one person or two persons. Yeah, we have a limited, of course, a limited budget, and we also would like to spend more on other activities. So we just said CIP will take next LTS kernel every 2 to 4 years. And as you know, CIP also allows some future backport. But There is one project called LTSI, Long-Term Support Initiative Project. They also allow to backport to the LTS versions. So we don't reinvent wheel this kind of effort for next time, because 4.4 is unfortunately not LTSI kernel version, because LTSI project skipped last year, but we decided kernel version last year. So, but next version, so we're planning to synchronize with LTSI to backporting efforts. So this is overall of the SLTS kernel development. So next topic is CIP testing. So the purpose of CIP testing is not so much different to the other project. We would like to detect bugs, and we would like to detect regressions for future, and also performance regressions. And of course, important is provide test results in a timely manner. So we would like to keep continue testing for the on the SLTS versions. So we defined four milestones. At the beginning, we would like to start setup for a single developer, which means a single developer can test their SLTS kernel on the desk with their development board. So this is our first milestone. Yeah. And next version, next milestone is a CIP kernel testing. Of course, we start a regular basis testing and then share results with other CIP community members. And after that, we define a kernel testing as a service within CIP, and then first three milestones focusing on kernel testing. And after that, we also consider to extend from the kernel testing to system testing. So this kind of this is also documented on our wiki. If you are interested in the more details, please go to our wiki site. And current status is almost done for first milestone. So I can say in between one and two now. So the first milestone is a board at desk and for single developer. The goal for this milestone is to create and publish a VM image that contains KernelCI and Lava 2. And this kind of VM image can be used by a single developer to test a CIP kernel or, of course, other kernels. And current status is KernelCI and Lava have been merged into one VM. KernelCI runs on the something Ubuntu or Debian, and Lava runs on the Debian and Ubuntu. Difficult to merge, but we solved this kind of issues. And now beta version just released a half hour ago. Okay, yeah. If you go to a CIP development mailing list, you can find the post. So. And all source code available on the CIP GitLab project website. So next, what we considered for next step is we also collaborate with other testing projects, such as, of course, KernelCI and Lava and Fuego. Because currently, we forked KernelCI and Lava and put it into the one VM. But unfortunately, currently we have local changes. So we would like to contribute to such kind of changes to upstream project, of course. And also, currently KernelCI and Lava on KernelCI projects are mainly focusing on the boot tests, on development tests. But we would like to extend this kind of test more flexible. So maybe we can collaborate with Fuego with this purpose. So CIP members will plan to join Fuego boss. It will be held at tomorrow at lunchtime, maybe around lunchtime, at the same place. So please come here for Fuego buff, testing buff tomorrow. So we would like to discuss in more deeply how to collaborate each other. So this is a very recent development status for CIP kernel testing. And now I move to CIP core package development. So at the beginning, there are four milestones, as I said. We started to define an initial component set. As I said, our base layer includes minimum component set at the beginning. So an initial component set has to be smaller as possible. And of course, current situation, current status is milestone one. The reason why I put one line in between one and two is I think there are huge gaps in between that. So to decide the component version, we should talk with upstream maintainer at the beginning. So this is not done by yet. So before deciding kernel component versions, we would like to talk to upstream maintainer. But I can show you what is the initial component set for CIP base layer. So this is quite simple. We have, of course, we have a CIP SLTS kernel with preempt RT patch and backported features. And on the user end or other part of that, we should have bootloader and utilities and base library, a toolchain, and security stuffs. So this is a kind of our initial base layer. So, but to development this kind of base layer, we also consider to keep development packages for reproducible builds. But we consider this kind of development package is not part of super long term support. Maybe we should focus in on the core packages. And unfortunately, we didn't decide any component version yet. But we decided to start CIP Project X. All right, please, Kraja, please. Okay. The question is, how long support will we support for this kind of component? Currently we are considered as the same as super long-term support kernel trees. Yeah, this is why it makes difficult to decide the component versions. So, is it okay for that? Okay. So. Yeah, CIP decides to start Project X. So this is just a tentative name. But we started an incubation project for minimum base systems. This project will provide the way to test the installable image. So the goal is first we use Debian source code and CIP kernel as input, and then build installable image by using a bitbake or Debian build systems. And output is minimum deployable base systems. So we try to create this deployable image at the beginning. So this is just started. So our development plan is showing on this slide. I usually use this slide. So this is just the initial state. Now we make our base layer as minimized as possible, but we would like to extend this base layer to fit our requirements. So first step is just defined initial set, then support more packages later. So I would like to summarize my current presentations before going to the latter part of my presentations. So we have already selected the first CIP kernel as 4.4, and we also decided initial maintainer as Ben-Hutton. And we also defined CIP kernel maintenance policies. It is available on CIP website. And we also developed an initial board platform, a defined platform, and provides support for them. Currently, we are using a BigBone block and Renaissance board in near future for as an initial board set. Because most of member companies using such kind of chipset. So, and we also developed a CIP kernel testing as name of the board at desk single developer. It's available on the website. And also we started CIP Project X. This is our latest development status of the inside our project. So let me explain what next step. So the next step by CIP, we would like to extend board at desk in single developer. Currently, just merged kernel CI and Lava 2 into one versions. So which means just testing for boot testing or build testing or something like that. So we would like to increase testing coverage for to define milestone 2. And of course, we would like to improve integrations with other testing projects, something like Fuego and Lava. Yeah, we start discussing with upstream projects. And for the kernel maintenance, we just started the kernel maintenance. So this is the first year for our experience to extend our kernel maintenance. We also defined our next step, what we need for kernel maintenance. So, and for core package development, which includes a base layer, we also has to be analyzed many packages and also discussing with our upstream maintainers as part of the CIP base layer. So to do that, we would like to collaborate with upstream projects, something like KernelCI or Fuego and year 2038 project. This is quite an important issue for us, and kernel self-protection project, and also real-time Linux work group. So if you are interested in this kind of effort, please join us. So after that, maybe something like promotion. So why join the CIP is, of course, we are a collaborative project. Membership is needed to join that. So, but the value of membership is, if you join our project, the members still participate in project decisions and technical decisions, what we need for civil infrastructure systems. Of course, we participate, bring your use cases and ideas in the right form and can be contribute with upstream project with other members, and also can be learn how to contribute with upstream project. And last, collaboration, we can share the knowledge and effort each other. This is a quite big value for us. So please feel free to contact to us. So if you're interested in our membership, please contact the Linux Foundation. And this is our contact person in the Linux Foundation. But in the other words, we have many public resources available, which include the CIP mailing list, development mailing list. This is a public mailing list. So please contact, please feel free to contact what we need or what you have, what kind of issues you have, or what you want to do, or what you, something like that. Any any comment is welcome for us. So call for new partitions. Overall, CIP provides super long-term maintained industrial-grade embedded Linux platform. So current member is Hitachi, Siemens, Renesas, and Toshiba. And Renesas just joined last month. This is Renesas is a first SoC vendor in the CIP project. And the Siemens member is a ColdSync and platform. So we joined together to provide super long-term supported embedded platform. So this is overall my presentation. So any questions? Yeah, please.
Let's say you're almost 20 years down the road. So it's like you're maintaining a kernel from 1997 today, right? Or something like that.
Yeah.
With how fast the Linux kernel moves in particular, it's going to be very hard to backport patches over time, right? It'll be completely, nothing is ever going to merge successfully. You'll basically have to rewrite a lot of code in the end. And contributing upstream will be also very difficult. Testing your kernel, testing the other kernel, they're so diverge, it's a really hard problem, right? Obviously, you can always just throw a lot of effort at it, and people can just try really hard, but it's a very difficult thing. Do you have any strategies or thoughts for how to make that easier, especially, you know, 3 years in, kind of easy, 5 years, fine, 10 years, it's getting hard, 15, 20, really, really, really hard.
So the question is if we continue to maintain for super long time, after several years, we are difficult to upstream our patches to upstream. But how to solve this kind of issues? Is that the answer? We don't want to maintain by ourselves. At first, we should have this kind of fixes upstream first, then backport it, not the other directions. But of course, after several years, we consider to we will face difficulties to backporting from the upstream project. Don't have correct answers, but for example, experienced maintainer have already done that for many years. So currently, we consider to ask this kind of maintainers to have some backporting, or Okay.
So as anybody who's taking a look at kernels 10 years old at this point and see what it would take to backward into security updates, has that investigation been done to get us kind of scope going on effort required to maintain this?
Ben Hutchings maintains the kernel. Well, it was actually not Ben. There was another maintainer who was maintaining 2.4 at the security.
Okay.
So it has been done.
Gotcha.
Great. I think there's a point where it's no longer backwards on the right word.
Yeah, backwards.
Right.
So, please.
One question I had was about the 2 to 3 year period where you are willing to take in some feature backports. Does that include platform backports or like a new SoC or some new platform that's not present in 4.4?
So that depends on our requirements. Yeah. But most of the features belongs to SoC backports probably, because we have to So if the kind of backport is concretely separated into other parts, maybe easy to backport. But otherwise, we don't want to have serious issues for that. Please.
So one of the features that's down the roadmap is dealing with updates and security including and chain of trust and all that stuff. But they usually have requirements of bootloaders and features of bootloaders, and I see you're choosing to slice the stack the kernel and not looking at anything below the kernel. Is that by choice or what's the rationale behind that? Why are you not trying to standardize bootloader as well?
We have a bootloader, a U-boot. So the question is, we have a bootloader, but we also have, we also maintain that bootloader for a long time. Is it correct?
Yeah, I'm wondering if you're thinking about the layer below the kernel too.
Sometimes the bootloader have serious security issues, and we would like to fix this kind of security issues for a long time. Yeah, which means maintained for a long time. Please.
So I wonder, the kernel is pretty big, I think, and I don't know how many lines of code it is compared to, say, GLibC, but I assume that there are many different kind of architectures and many different subsystems. So I wonder if you have done any, have any ideas how to sort of evaluate different components, how stable they're operating.
The question is, kernel is quite big, and many configurations is available on that. And to maintain whole stuff is quite difficult. And how to maintain? The question is, do we have an idea to maintain such kind of stuff, defined scopes? Okay. Of course, kernel is quite big stuff. So, but our requirement is limited. So. Which means we should define, for example, when we testing the kernel, we should say this is our tested environment, which includes these features and these features and these features. So this is a tested part. So the other coverage is not tested yet. So something like that.
Does that mean you would have a particular kconfig settings that you would say this is okay, this has been tested, and other config?
So at the initial state, we would like to define some initial configurations. But at the later, we would like to extend this kind of components and feature sets. Sorry, I couldn't get correct.
So GLibC, GCC tools to target the long term. Are they part of this project? What would be effort to ensure that I can develop updates to my applications that are running on that kernel?
The question is, for example, GLibC and GCC is a part of core maintenance. So use it. Is it able to run for a long time period or not? Is that correct?
Right. So I've got, you know, a windmill or an airplane that's out there for 10 years, and I'm not updating the kernel, but I think all our software development tools change over time. And
I think the compatibility, maybe this kind of issues, they are kind of compatibility issues. So we don't want to get some regressions in between the fixes. So this is why we would like to have a continuous testing environment inside the CIP kernel. So which means we also consider we don't have regressions for the our base layer.
More directly, will you be freezing the compiler along with the packages and everything?
The question is, will we be freezing a compiler and packaging for everything? Current plan is yes. Yeah.
No, it's realistic to expect compiling the old software stack in 10 years with the latest compiler.
Right. That seems the same thing to me.
So, please.
So, I noticed one of the things you mentioned was that there's going to be a first process, sorry, plan for how things get backported into what you're doing. I think that's a great policy to have. I also noticed that you mentioned that you're going to be basing things off of the LTSI, possibly in the next one. How do you reconcile those two? Because the LTSI does accept things that aren't yet in upstream to be in their kernel tree.
OK. The question is, so upstream first policy is a great policy in CIP kernel. But the current LTSI accepts the non-upstream features. So how to solve this kind of? We discussed with LTSI persons yesterday, and they currently have an upstream first policy too. So. So, please.
I'm not familiar with how the testing is done on the kernel. Are you adding, you talked about continuous testing on the kernel, is that adding features that aren't available right now on the mainstream kernel? How do you verify that when you pull in patches, you've still got the stable version that you started with?
So we would like to have a continuous testing environment. So based on the.
I think the question is, are you adding anything to the kernel to support that continuous integration?
Or adding capabilities.
Inside the kernel tree. The question is, we'll be adding some continuous testing inside the kernel. Is that the right question? No. Right, understand?
I guess I'm trying to understand how you make the judgment call between what is a security risk that needs fixing and how much jeopardy or risk you put into what's already stable and how you confirm it's not stable. And I'm just trying to wrap my head around that, how that's done nowadays with the main current kernel versus are you adding new technology to do that, new test cases, new integration strategy?
Oh, I see.
Well, my understanding is
they'll
be adding a whole bunch of tests, but they're all external to the kernel, so they're not altering.
I guess what I'm saying is, so we don't do that right now with the kernel. We don't have a test.
No, you'd be surprised at how, as an industry, it's very ad hoc.
Sorry. It's okay. Please.
Some of the medical industry or those kind of things, or some of the others.
Mm-hmm. The question is, currently we're focusing on civil infrastructure, but we also extended under our focus industry. So what kind of industry will we focus in the future? So I think, our technical scope is sometimes not only belongs to the civil infrastructure. Of course, consider to use this kind of stuff in the healthcare stuff and this kind of critical stuff. So this, if there are any products need to have industrial grade quality, it is a kind of focusing on the industry. But
we are already in discussion with the automotive folks on the testing because we share the same requirements.
Yeah.
So that's already on the technical level ongoing.
Yeah.
So I'm just wondering, some of the other industry kind of with this product, they will be another requirement and may cause some sort of conflict in between. Maybe you will be required to make some of the adjusting those kind of requirements, which sometimes might be.
Yeah. The comment is, if we extend our focus industry, we will face some conflict in between our requirement or new member requirements. So in that case, this is a collaborative project. We have to discuss with this kind of members. So, we are open to discussing with other members such as automotive also. Yeah. Please.
Trying to manage these versions for, again, 10 to 20 years. User space often isn't as careful about their APIs, their ABIs, and so on as the kernel has to be. Python 2 to 3, HTML 0.1 to 1.0, there's all sorts of these examples. And in addition, there's often this huge dependency set for each of these versions. And, distros doing, let's say Debian stable with a 2 to 3 year release cycle, they already have enough issues trying to
keep a package version. It can be hard. But 10 to 20 years, that gets harder. Do you have any strategies for dealing
with that? And also, do you plan to tightly constrain user space to a pretty small package set? Or do you think that you would allow a lot of packages?
Yeah. Okay. Do you have a comment?
The set will be small.
Very small.
Very small. First request already came up regarding multimedia.
Yeah.
This is one of the bigger sets, probably.
Of course, it could come in everything. Yeah.
So initially, as long as we are a smaller group, I suppose this is going to be challenging if we didn't take this hit.
Right.
Eventually, it may come. Eventually, these kind of infrastructures or this kind of packages may actually also become more palatable for this infrastructure. So it's maybe a two-dimensional thing. So we try to enable certain things.
I imagine at some point you have to say, we know most of the pack, and then eventually you say, yes, if you commit full time to maintaining this and being very careful about your
But if you look at the devices at the end, there will always be specific things in these devices anyway, which the individual application bring in, and that's in the end the responsibility of these device integrators to care for this. And if there is so much commodity in this additional things coming in, we may look into this. But yeah, you can't promise anything which is not handleable for the group. So better say no than say yes, of course, and then fail on it. Right?
Okay.
That may happen. We'll have to see. But of course, the ideal case is that we don't have a PSP.
Yeah.
Okay.
Provide a platform, which is the first step to reduce the
Okay, excuse me. Also, time is up, I think. So thank you very much for attending my presentations. Thank you.